Deputy Derek Haleary, please.
Thank you, Ken Curler. Ken Curler, as elected representatives, we have the honour in this House of being given responsibility to debate issues and to introduce legislation to improve the lives of our citizens, to improve the life of a country. There will always be political differences. It's a political job. There will be heated debates, there will be slagging matches, but overall, everybody here is committed to actually trying to make a difference, to make a positive difference in the communities. We always have to take into consideration how the public, who elect us and who we serve, believe an issue should be dealt with. Over the past 2 weeks, Minister, there have been heated exchanges about the chaotic, irresponsible nature that Cervical Check have handled their audit on cervical smears. This was brought to public light by Vicky Phelan, who was forced to take her case and to tell her story to the High Court. But the bravery that she showed has now opened up so much developments in terms of scoping inquiries, processes, data collections, inquiries into laboratories here in the USA. But at all times, I felt that there was very little discussion on women and on the impact on women. 17 of these women are already dead. The courage of Stephen Teep in telling the story of his late wife Irene is amazing. And he and 17 families are now digesting the fact that their wives or their mothers could have had a better prognosis, a better chance in life, had their smears been read properly. However, this morning, Minister, if any of us were in any doubt about the impact of these mistakes, the interview on Morning Ireland by Audrey Carville with Emma McMahona would have blown that complacency away. It's an interview that will stay with anyone who heard it. It seared the soul of our country. It's hard not to be completely distraught, Minister, at the devastating heartbreak that Emma and her family are facing. And there are no words that anybody can say that will console her, her five children, her family or her friends. She articulated in an unbelievably brave way that she was told in 2013 that her smear test was normal, yet she was diagnosed with cervical cancer in 2016. Yesterday, she met her own GP, who told her she had terminal cancer. It had spread to her bones. And she waited until her child's confirmation, which was held on Tuesday, was over to get that news. Her GP told her, and her gynaecologist confirmed, that if her smear test was read accurately, that she would not be facing this diagnosis now. In her own words, Minister, she said that this is where it's so more heartbreaking. I am dying and I don't need to die. She's 37. She's five children, one of whom is a baby. And she said, I don't even know if my baby will remember me. I don't even know if my baby will remember me. Minister, the time for defiant defence is over. It's not a time to defend the realm anymore, defend the government, defend the HSC. Please stop. Please stop as a government and listen. But more importantly, hear. Hear the story of Emma, the story of Vicky Phelan, the story of Irene Teep and all of the deceased women and all of the women who are currently going through this journey at the moment. Emma's only one story in an ocean of anguish. Minister, I want you to give your thoughts on whether all of these women have been failed by the state. And do you believe there should be accountability and that there should be accountability now?
Thank you, Deputy Minister.
Thank you, Cian Corla, I heard the interview this morning to which the Deputy is referring to. And it was a bright morning this morning. I heard Emma speak about her family, about her community, and about how she feels about all of the normal things in life that, of course, sometimes you can take for granted until they're taken away from you. And the tragedy that she spoke of, the anguish, the anger, and the fear regarding her life, regarding the consultation that she has to have tomorrow and regarding what it means for her and her family, were harrowing to hear, and therefore there are a few words that I can offer that can recognise the scale of tragedy and vast difficulty that Emma and her family are grappling with at the moment. And as the Deputy has acknowledged, there has been much debate on this tragedy, on other women who have been affected by it over the last number of weeks in this House. And none of us here have a monopoly on compassion, on anguish, and what we heard this morning reminded us of this. To answer the Deputy's questions, of course, the Taoiseach, the Minister for Health, and the entire government are absolutely committed to doing two things. Firstly, to ensuring that we establish why this happened, who is accountable, and how this can be prevented in the future. And this is why the government has put in place a scoping inquiry in relation to the issue that will provide an interim report in the next number of weeks and a final report shortly afterwards. This is independent. It's not done by government. It's enabled by government to get to the bottom quickly of what has happened, and we will move afterwards to a full commission of inquiry in relation to the issue. On accountability now, there are two individuals who no longer are in post, no longer performing their den duties, because of the recognition of the scale of difficulty, the scale of tragedy that has been created. And furthermore, the second priority of the government was to put in place all the supports that we can to offer support to women and to offer comfort to women at a time of such great vulnerability. This is why we have put in place the independent review of all audits that have taken place. This is why we quickly moved to put in place availability of consultations and further smear tests if needed. And of course, this is why a helpline was so quickly set up to provide consultations to women who clearly need and deserve this. But in conclusion, Deputy, I am aware, if you juxtapose my words and the actions that we are taking against the anguish that was on our airwaves this morning, it is action that is needed. The government has taken action, and we are committed, for the sake of Emma, for the sake of everybody else, to see this through, establish what has happened, and provide all the support that can be provided to women at a time of such great anguish and need.
Thank you, Minister. Deputy Cleary.
There are no words, Minister, and I accept that. But the actions you speak about are not meeting the challenge. Emma was hugely complimentary this morning about her own GP, about her gynaecologist, but her own GP, like all other GPs in the country, only got a proper information pack last night as to how to deal with the avalanche of concern they have in their surgeries. 2 weeks. 2 weeks after this case. The professionalism of Emma's team isn't going to make it any easier for her at 37 years of age. And what she said this morning, she said the state had failed her, had let her down, and she said the government is not actually capable of minding us. Yet this morning at public accounts, when the DG of the HSC was challenged about this interview, he, against the background of all of that has been caused by this controversy, he accused Deputy Mark McSharry of causing hysteria and spreading hysteria. Yet he won't take accountability for his own role in this. Minister, we don't need words. We don't need promises. We don't need shouting or roaring in this chamber. We need action. We need action that will show Emma, that will show Vicky, that will show Stephen and all of the affected women that this House, that this legislature, that each and every one of us here who are given the honour of being in here, get where they are. We actually understand we'll never be able to walk that journey with them. But as politicians, do we get where they are and get, understand and show why they need accountability? Because they may not see the end of an inquiry. They may not see the report. Minister, please, please, for the sake of our country, show that as a government that you are actually capable of dealing with this.
Thank you, Deputy Minister.
I am pointing to actions that have been taken, that are underway, in recognition of the grief, the tragedy and the great uncertainty that too many of our citizens face at the moment, too many women who face at the moment, who I believe were let down. And because they were let down, we need to understand how this happened and what support can be given. I've outlined the actions the government has taken. I've pointed to an inquiry that is already underway that will be reporting as soon as possible in an independent way to establish why this has happened and who and what is responsible for it. So the words that I'm offering here today look to do two things. The first thing they look to do is an offer, in whatever limited way any of us can, a recognition of the scale of tragedy that we heard this morning on our airwaves. But alongside that, what I'm also pointing to, Deputy, is the actions that have already been taken by government over the last number of days since this tragedy became apparent to the House and to the government, actions that have been taken and actions that will continue to be taken. And of course, alongside this, Deputy, as is correct and proper, so many of the individuals and organisations that you have referred to have been in front of Oireachtas committees virtually all week, demonstrating that accountability is happening now. But in addition to this, the support the government is and will give in relation to review of audits, in relation to making sure that support is available to GPs and women who want and need further smear tests,
in relation
to the helpline, all of that is there. That is action that has been taken, and more will be taken as we deepen our understanding and our inquiry of what has happened to these women.